How fine is fine art? So stay tuned, I'm going to show you with my squirrel painting and how fine you can get with watercolours. My name is Paul Hopkinson and I'm a professional watercolour artist, and I teach online on my website how to paint realistic wildlife to help you with this fantastic medium of watercolour. How fine is fine art? Now, does it depend on the brushes that you use, the type of brushes, how you use these brushes, how much paint you have on your brush, or even the amount of pressure you apply when you start painting? So I'm going to go through some little tips in this video to give you some ideas how fine you can get when painting with watercolours. Now, when I work on a nose, I notice that you tend to have a lot of fine marks, a lot of more stippling, you know, like little tiny dots really. And these can be used initially just for making the outline. Because one thing you don't want to do with anything like this is draw a very straight line or just an even line all the way around, like a big curve. Because you find that when you look at a nose from a side angle, you can see all the bumps and kind of contours within all the texture within that nose. Because there usually is, isn't there, when you look at an animal's nose, they're not normally that smooth. Some can be, yes I know, but very often with animals such as a red squirrel or a dog or cat, it tends to be a little bit bumpy, a little bit very small depressions as you look around. So by working around the nose using the stippling technique, then you can create that more of a slightly roughened feel, which it really is, to the nose itself. Now what I like to do as well, use a little bit of burnt umber in this case, just to branch some of the hairs onto the top of the nose, because that sort of kind of gels it together, kind of brings that together. And then we can carry on working on the nose thereafter. So back to the nose again, and I'm really considering the depths of tone within these hairs that we're working on, again, above the nose. But you've got to think about the more of a kind of the definition between those hairs. So you've got to really have the lights and the darks, and overlapping them slightly as well along the way. The other thing as well is that when you've got a lot of colours already mixed up, you don't need to use them all in one go, because I know they'll dry, but the good thing about watercolours is that you can just simply reactivate that paint, just add a little bit of water to it, and it's ready to go again. Yes, it'll very often weaken that colour down just a little bit, but it's well worth doing that, so just remember that. So this is a mixture of alizarin crimson and opera rose. I wanted that, again, for the nose, because we've got that kind of a pinky feel, haven't we, to the tip of the nose. So that kind of adds that colour in straight away. And then we can start to mix a darker colour, a little bit of brown, a little bit of black, just so we can get more of a kind of three-dimensional feel to it, really. So reactivate the brown paint again, add a little bit of black in there. And I want this more to a creamy consistency. So I'm going to load it, I'm going to roll it, I'm going to pull it away from the mixing palette, and then I'll tap it on some kitchen roll off camera and then start to build up the edges of this nose. Now this is where we've got to really consider the overall shape. You see, as with all watercolours, you've still got to work from light to dark. Okay, so you've got to remember that as you build up any details in watercolours. At least that way you can still reserve those light areas or you add the darker areas around the edges. Also consider those fine shapes underneath the nose. And just notice that if you think about the nose as the middle of a clock face, and these lines go around the clock, and as I say, the center of the clock is the middle of the nose, then you can work out the overall angles that come away from that central point. At least that way, you should be able to get the shape just about right as well. And all I'm doing for that is just using a flicking out technique, as you can see, just kind of get those little marks on. Now one thing I do as well, before you reload that brush, make use of it. Well, I know it's nearly dry, I know it's nearly kind of run out of paint, but really make use of that. Because you find that when you've got hardly any paint on the brush or using a dry brush effect, then that will give you the finest of marks, the finest of lines on your watercolour surface. Now the photo isn't really dark, but we do need to add a suggestion just to show the light within a painting as well. So this is going back to that dry brush technique, as you can see, just to make sure that we've got the very fine lines, very fine marks at the same time. And I'm going to keep going until I've completely run out of paint. But you can see the way that these lines are just gradually building up as we go along there, just by making sure to keep, as I say, hardly any paint on the brush. but goes to show what you can achieve just by adding those lines bit by bit. Okay, back to more colour, but this time I want to start defining the edge of the cheeks themselves. I'm trying to sort of separate the cheeks from the rest of the face, really, in a way. I want them to kind of sort of stand forward, really. But by adding these darker marks, not too bold though, remember, just very fine, very detailed, around the edge of the cheeks, that allow that part of the face to kind of stand forward a little bit more. Because, obviously, naturally, because it's looking at us, that's the area that's closest to the camera, isn't it? So that's the area that you really want to concentrate on to kind of bring it forward. I'm also varying the length of the lines at the same time. Even though I've just about run out of paint again, haven't I? You know, also, when you work slowly and gradually, when you're building up the detail, you got to take your time and it will start to work for you. It really honestly will start to work. It'll start to come together. All you have to remember is to allow some of those details underneath, those lighter details underneath, to still show through. Otherwise, well, what's the point in painting them in the first place? I know. So I'm going to carry on with the nose and carry on with this kind of stippling technique along the nose. But this time I'm going to go for a slightly darker mix and start adding some more contrasting colours within it as well. But this is where you can start to gradually, on these mid-tones, sort of get the overall shape starting to form. And you can see, from when I first started talking about this nose at the beginning of this video, you can now start to see it gradually coming together. And it's like my members usually say, Paul, you know, nothing's working. Why is it not working? Well, you only were halfway through a painting. And you tend to find a painting very often comes together much more so when you get those contrasting colours on. Because we're working, as I say, from light to dark, and you get through to the mid-tones, that's when you start to see things starting to come together. It starts to happen, doesn't it? This is why, now working with this mid-tone, I can gradually start to build up more of the details and more contrasting colours within both the body and the head, and even just around underneath the right-hand cheek here. At least this way around, I can start to define the overall shapes. So again, I'm looking at the length of the lines. I'm also trying to pick out where on the face of this red squirrel, where the curves go in, you know? So you've got to think about the contours and the way they tend to turn in towards the body. This is also why I say keep checking that reference photograph, okay? Now my eyes are flicking backward and forward, every few seconds to that photograph. It's that way around. I tend to kind of sort of got it kind of locked in my mind the way that the shapes and the details go. So having the photograph in front of you on a tablet or an iPad or even printed out as well, it's a good way of kind of just referring to it every few seconds back and forward, so you can try and get those shapes and those colours and those details about right. The good thing about when you start working on the sort of darker areas, you find you don't need quite as much paint. Honestly, you don't. You've already put all these layers on there ready to go. So you've done all the preparation work of all these different layers on the fur. So when you add the darker contrasting colours on, you still want a lot of that kind of lighter fur to show through, which basically means you're not using half as much paint, and it could take probably a lot less time than it would do when you first started this. After all, you've already done the majority of the work, haven't you? Now, because we've got some of the contrasting colours on already, I'm going to just increase some of the light colours. And all this is a little bit of watercolour white. That's it. It's only using a bit of watercolour white. You can use white gouache as well if you want to. And this is just to bring out some of those highlights, like, for example, around the eye, or even that little bit of sparkle, that bit of life within the eye as well. Now, one thing I like to do with the white paint is just make sure that when I'm working with fine details, I keep washing that brush out because it can start to clog that brush up a little bit. But remember though, just remember one thing, will you please? Don't put too much white on. It's so easy. I've done it many times in the past. I have, honestly. To kind of get carried away adding white paint onto the paper. Because then if you do that and you do it far too much, let's just say this cute young looking red squirrel will look extremely old, will age it very, very quickly indeed. So only use it in small amounts. And when you do put white paint on, you think, do I need any more? Just walk away. Go make a cup of coffee. Come back about 10 minutes, half an hour later. Then decide. So come back with fresh eyes and have a look at it from a cleaner, fresher perspective. Now, one thing I also do when I'm working with white paint, once it's dry, I tint it. Okay? I tint it down with a little bit of colour. But to do this, you've got to make sure that you do this very lightly, in one fell swoop, one very light pass of colour. If you go over that more than once, you'll find that white paint will move. So bear that in mind. Once that's dry again, you can then go over the top if you wish to, with even more white. So let's say around the sides of the nose, down to the cheeks area. So I'm working around there just to add more little fine lines in there, but still allowing some of that dark areas to show through. I don't want to cover all that detail up underneath, remember. So bear that in mind when you're working with white, or even black as I mentioned. Now I do like to take my time when I'm using white paint and using the very lightest of touches as well. So remember to load that brush up carefully like I've already spoken about. So use a very fine tip, barely loaded brush, at least that way you'll get some very light lines. We're using literally two hairs in air, so hardly any pressure whatsoever when you work with watercolour white. And again, remember, not too much, okay? Another good use for white paint as well is that if you don't want it to be white, but you want it to be, I don't know, a dull version of white, kind of knock back a little bit, you can add a little bit more water to it. Because the more water you add to white paint, the duller the white paint will dry. You find it just sort of not quite fade away, but it just goes quite dull. So I'm using a little bit of that on the tip of the nose, on the edge of the nose, just because I don't want it to be too colourful around there. And then I can just add a little bit more thicker white if I want to, once this is dry obviously, if I need to kind of brighten it again in places. Think about the central area of the head as it works down and the way it kind of V's apart. Okay, so bear that in mind. Because I noticed that with all the animals I've painted, when you go between the eyes, right to the centre of the top of the head, if they're facing spot on dead in front of you like this, then you find the hairs sort of part commonly, don't they? Right from the middle area. So that way around, you've got to think about where those angles go. That's why, before I actually start a painting, I do a lot of mapping out first. Kind of work it all out, where all these lines go. At least then you've got a good idea before you start on how you're going to approach that painting. But with every layer of paint that you add on, every layer of fur that you work with, be it 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, or 8 layers of paint. I know, you can go as many layers as you want to. Every layer has to be painted in the same direction, okay? But remember those elongated long crosses, okay? Just so it doesn't look as if you've just come back from the barbers, because it can do if you're not careful. But notice how I'm working with different length of lines, different consistencies of this white paint. And for this particular animal, this will be the final layer. So even though traditionally you would normally start off light and work your way to dark and go as far as that, in this case, basically what I've done, I've gone from light to dark and then, well, back to light again, haven't I? Just by using watercolour white over the top. You do have to make sure that when you use white paint that it's more of a creamy consistency and that white paint is certainly opaque in nature, because you can get semi-opaque whites as well. And you find they won't cover nearly as good as the one I'm using today. So just have a shop around and see what you can find. You know, like I did with some of the other colours, the white can be used to sort of bridge gaps as well, so it doesn't look sort of disjointed, because it can look disjointed if you're not careful. So where I've added the white to the right hand side below the eye there, then I can just gradually pull a little bit of that across to branch into the fur below. Otherwise it'll look too sort of sectioned off, won't it? And I can start working the lower part of the body now, adding this white paint again. I know, makes a difference, doesn't it, just by using watercolour white. But again, varying that consistency of the white paint as I went my way down. So I'm looking at where it's really light on the photograph and where it's not quite so light. And obviously to adjust that, I'll just simply add a little bit more water. But when you do add more water, steal some of that white paint and take it out of one mixing well and pop it into a fresh one. At least that way, you can have more than one mix of white, can't you? You can have a creamy mix, and you can have more of a kind of milky or even a watery mix version of it as well. So let's add some highlights to the little nut, okay? And again, just barely touching it with the very, very, very tip of the brush. Don't go too heavy-handed with this. And as per usual, once it's dry, if I want to, I can just tone that down with just a little tiny amount of colour. Because the thing is white, isn't it? At the end of the day, it's white. So you can't just have just pure white in it, so not all the time. Sometimes you can, depends on the subject matter, of course. But it's very often I would kind of tone some, not all, of the white down. You also tend to notice when you're working on wildlife as well, is that you tend to see that a lot of the fur, as it comes down away from the head, gets longer. In this case, you can see that, you know, instantly, can't you? So the fur around between the eyes and down to the nose, the bridge of the nose, are very short, very, very tiny indeed. But as it works its way down the body, you can see how long these are getting on the left-hand side here. So while I'm adding this watercolour white just for highlighting, not bright white, remember, this is more of a kind of milky consistency now. And look at the direction they all go. So they're kind of heading more towards a, what would you say, sort of a 9 o'clock direction, aren't they? This is also where you can pull out a few finer hairs around the edge of the ear and the body as you work your way down. This also in turn sort of breaks up the edge as well, doesn't it? Kind of breaks up that overall line around the edge of the squirrel and separates, as I mentioned earlier on, with the top right-hand corner of the face from the tail behind, because obviously we don't want that all mixing together, do we? We need the squirrel to look as if it's further forward than the tail. You have to be very careful when you're working around paws because of the fact that every individual finger, if you wish, or toe, tends to be quite round, doesn't it? So you've got to highlight that roundness. You've got to think about the overall shape when you're adding the white paint on. Only put it on in small areas. So for example, the nails, they obviously catch the light in this case. So you're going to highlight those nails. But only put a small amount on because otherwise you can overdo it on the paws. And again, they'll look far too white and far too old. And I mentioned about the paws and adding the finest of details on there. Now my brush in this case is barely loaded at all with white paint. And you can see the effect it's creating just by lightly grazing in the right direction, of course. Okay, I don't keep going on about directions and angles all the time, but you've got to bear that in mind with everything that you paint. So just adding the finest of marks, the finest of touches around the paws is all that needs to kind of finish these areas off. But vary those angles, overlap those lines as you do so.